Now, slave, how long am I to wait for my chariot? Thundered the witch. Uncle Andrew cowered away from her. Now that she was really present, all the silly thoughts he'd had while looking at himself in the glass were oozing out of him. But Aunt Letty at once got up from her knees and came over to the centre of the room. And who is this young person, Andrew, may I ask? Said Aunt Letty in icy tones. A distinguished foreigner, a very important person, he stammered. Rubbish, said Aunt Letty. And then, turning to the witch, get out of my house this moment, you shameless hussy, or I shall send for the police. She thought the witch must be someone out of a circus, and she did not approve of bare arms. What woman is this? Said Jardis. Down on your knees, minion, before I blast you. And no strong language in this house, if you please, young woman, said Aunt Letty. Instantly, as it seemed to Uncle Andrew, the Queen towered up to an even greater height. Fire flashed from her eyes. She flung out her arm with the same gesture and the same horrible words that had lately turned the palace gates of Charn to dust. But nothing happened, except that Aunt Letty, thinking those horrible words were meant to be ordinary English, said, I thought as much. The woman is drunk. Drunk. She can't even speak clearly. It must have been a terrible moment for the witch when she suddenly realised that her power of turning people to dust, which had been quite real in her own world, was not going to work in ours. But she didn't lose her nerve, not even for a second. Without wasting a thought on her disappointment, she lunged forward, caught Aunt Letty round the neck and knees, raised her high above her head as if she'd been no heavier than a doll, and threw her across the room. While Aunt Letty was still hurtling through the air, the housemaid, who was having a perfectly beautiful, exciting morning, put her head in at the door and said, If you please, sir, the Ansoms come. Lead on, slave, said the witch to Uncle Andrew. He began muttering something about regrettable violence, must really protest, but at a single glance from Jardis, he became speechless. She drove him out of the room and out of the house, and Diggory came running down the stairs just in time to see the front door close behind them. Jiminy, he said, she's loose in London, and with Uncle Andrew. I wonder what on earth's going to happen now. Oh, Master Diggory, said the housemaid, who was really having a wonderful day, I think Miss Kettley's hurt herself somehow. So they both rushed into the drawing room to find out what had happened. If Aunt Letty had fallen on bare boards, or even on the carpet, I suppose all her bones would have been broken. But by great good luck, she'd fallen on the mattress. Aunt Letty was a tough, very tough old lady. Aunts often were in those days. After she'd had some sal volatile and sat still for a few minutes, she said there was nothing matter with her except a few bruises. And very soon she was taking charge of the situation. Sarah, she said to the housemaid, who'd never had such a day before, go around to the police station at once and tell them there's a dangerous lunatic at large. I will take Mrs. Kirk's lunch up myself. Mrs. Kirk was, of course, Diggory's mother. When Diggory's mother's lunch had been seen to, Diggory and Aunt Letty had their own. And after that, he did some hard thinking. The problem was how to get the witch back to her own world, or at any rate, out of ours as soon as possible. Whatever happened, she must not be allowed to go rampaging around the house. Mother must not see her. And if possible, she mustn't be allowed to go rampaging around London either. Diggory had not been in the drawing room when she tried to blast Aunt Letty, but he had seen her blast the gates of Charn, so he knew her terrible powers, and he did not know that she'd lost any of them by coming into our world. And he knew she meant to conquer the world. At that present moment, as far as he could see, she might be blasting Buckingham Palace or the Houses of Parliament, and it was almost certain that quite a number of policemen by now had been reduced to little heaps of dust. And there didn't seem to be anything he could do about that. But the ring seemed to work like magnets, thought Diggory. If I can only touch her and then slip on my yellow, we shall both go to the wood between the worlds. I wonder if she'll go all faint again there. Was that something the place does to her, or was it only the shock of being pulled out of her own world? But I suppose I'll have to risk that. And how am I going to find the beast? I don't suppose Aunt Letty would let me go out, not unless I said where I was going. And I haven't got more than tuppence. I need any amount of money for buses and trams if I went looking all over London. Anyway, I haven't the faintest idea where to look. I wonder if Uncle Andrew's still with her. It seemed, in the end, that the only thing he could do was to wait and hope that Uncle Andrew and the witch would come back. If they did, he must rush out and get hold of the witch and put on his yellow ring before she had a chance to get into the house. This meant he must watch the front door like a cat watching a mouse's hole. He dared not leave his post for a moment. So he went to the dining room and glued his face, as they say, to the window. It was a box window from which you could see the steps up to the front door and see up and down the street so that no one could reach the front door without your knowing. I wonder what Polly's doing, thought Diggory. He wondered about this a good deal at first as the first hour ticked slowly by. But you need not wonder, for I'm going to tell you. She got home late for her dinner with her shoes and stockings very wet. And when they asked her where she'd been and what on earth she'd been doing, she said that she'd been out with Diggory Kirk. Under further questioning, she said she'd got her feet wet in a pool of water and that pool was in a wood. And when asked where the wood was, she said she didn't know. Asked if it was in one of the parks, she said truthfully enough that she supposed it might be a sort of a park. From all of this, Polly's mother got the idea that Polly had gone off, without telling anyone, to some strange part of London she didn't know, and had gone into a strange park and amused herself by jumping into puddles. As a result, she was told that she'd been very naughty indeed, and that she wouldn't be allowed to play with that Kirk boy any more if anything of the sort ever happened again. Then she was given dinner with all the nice parts left out and sent to her bed for 2 solid hours. It was a thing that happened to one quite often in those days. So, while Diggory was staring out of the dining room window, Polly was lying in bed and both were thinking how terribly slowly the time could go. I think myself, I'd rather have been in Polly's position. She only had to wait to the end of her 2 hours, but every few minutes Diggory would hear a cab or a baker's van or a butcher's boy coming round the corner and think, here she comes, and then find it wasn't. And in between those false alarms, for what seemed like hours and hours, the clock ticked on. And one big fly, high up and far out of reach, buzzed against the window. It was one of those houses that get very quiet and dull in the afternoon and always seem to smell of mutton. During his long wait, watching and waiting, one small thing happened, which I shall have to mention because something important came of it later on. A lady called with some grapes for Diggory's mother, and as the dining room door was open, Diggory couldn't help overhearing Aunt Letty and the lady as they talked in the hall. What lovely grapes, came Aunt Letty's voice. I'm sure if anything could do her good, these would. But poor dear little Mabel. I'm afraid it would need fruit from the land of youth to help her now. Nothing in this world will do much. Then they both lowered their voices and said a lot more than could be heard. Now, if he'd heard that bit about the land of youth a few days ago, he would have just thought that Aunt Letty was talking without meaning anything in particular, the way grown-ups do, and it wouldn't have interested him. He almost thought so now. But suddenly it flashed upon his mind that he now knew, even if Aunt Letty didn't, that there really were other worlds and that he himself had been in one of them. At any rate, there might be a real land of youth somewhere. There might be almost anything. There might be fruit in some other world that would really cure his mother. And, well, you know how it feels when you begin hoping for something that you want desperately badly. You almost fight against the hope because it's too good to be true. You've been disappointed so often before, and that was how Diggory felt. But it was no good trying to throttle this hope. It might really, really, it might just be true. So many odd things had happened already, and he had the magic rings. There must be worlds you could get to through every pool in the wood. He would hunt through them all. And then, mother, well again, everything right again. He forgot about watching for the witch. His hand was already going to his pocket when he kept the yellow ring, when all of a sudden he heard the sound of a gallop.